And I was accused of the service going along this morning that the Cracker Barrel had a search party looking out for some of you guys. And hopefully Shoney's won't have to look for you tonight. But it's good to be in God's house. I've enjoyed the whole service, enjoyed all the singing, the special singing, the fellowship. And there's no place I'd rather be in all this world except heaven than right here. And appreciate being here tonight. Appreciate you being here. And tonight we're going to take a text out of 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. As you turn there, when you get there, go ahead and stand for the reading of God's Word. And when everybody stood, I'll know you're there. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 10 tonight. I'm going to look at these 10 verses, but I'm going to specifically focus upon verse 8. And the message the Lord has been dealing with me on. 2 Timothy chapter 1, starting with verse 1. And here the Bible says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, according to the promise of life which is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father in Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve for my forefathers with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembered of thee in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois, and in thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. Wherefore I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee, by putting on of my hands. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, and of love, and of a sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou a partaker of the afflictions of the gospel, according to the power of God, who has served us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and of grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Father, thank you for the reading of your word tonight. I pray now that you anoint me for just a few minutes, God, to be able to expound upon this passage of scripture. And Lord, we'll give you the praise for it. In Jesus' name I pray, and amen. You can be seated. If you underline things in your Bible, I'd like for you to underline that part in verse 8, which says, be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord. Underline twice that word testimony. With the help of the Lord, I want to preach a message tonight that is dealing with your testimony. Your testimony. What a blessing the service was this morning, wasn't it? I mean, it was a real blessing to me. I mean, the Holy Spirit was here. He was so real, and I could just feel His presence. But I want you to know tonight, the Holy Spirit is here tonight as well. This morning's service is gone and over and done with, but tonight is a new night. And the Holy Spirit is here, and He's walking up and down these aisles, and He's in the hearts of those that are saved tonight, and He's guiding our worship service, and He's expecting us to lift Him up tonight, lift up the Lord through the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Well, last week I was going through my computer, and I was looking for old teaching soundtracks of my dad when he would teach. As you know, he would fill in for me on Wednesday nights, and sometimes on Sunday, I believe a few times. But I came upon one he had taught 3 years ago. Actually, it was in July the 24th, 2013. And I was listening to that audio of him speaking. And he did something in there that I never even realized he did. He did this, I believe, while I was on a business trip. And I must have missed it when I listened to it or uploaded it. But as I was listening to it, he made the statement that I don't believe that I've ever given my testimony here. And that's the way he started out. And he gave his testimony of how the Lord saved him and how he had ran and fought it for years up till he's 19 years old. Even as a young child being took to church every time the door was open, he was being convicted of the Holy Spirit to be saved, but yet he would refuse it. It wasn't until a revival service at North Acres Baptist Church when he was 19 years old that he gave his heart to the Lord Jesus. But he gave his entire testimony there that night for all of you that were here. He mentioned that he didn't think he'd ever shared his testimony with the church up to that point, not this church, and he wanted to share it. Well, ever since I heard the testimony of my dad, the Lord's been dealing with me about testimonies. And how appropriate it was this morning when Sister Karen shared the testimony of how the Lord had worked in her life and had saved her life when she was in such a bad time there, and the Lord had helped her out of it and restored her health, and the miracle that he performed. And she made a statement this morning, and actually she and Sister Shirley and Sister Linda, I believe, also made the same statement, that everybody sitting in here had a miracle in their life that the Lord had performed. And everybody has a testimony. In our opening text here, the Apostle Paul is speaking or writing to his dear son in the faith, Timothy. In fact, he called him his son, his dearly beloved son. It was not his fleshly son, but his spiritual son. And so he brought him along in the faith. I spoke about him a little this morning. But he said those words, "Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord." Well, that word testimony, it comes from a Greek word. It's pronounced marturion. It means to bear witness or evidence of or to testify of something. In other words, when you give a testimony, you are bearing witness to something that has happened in your life. You're saying with your hand raised, what is the old guy used to say, with my hand raised, I'm telling you the truth right now. You're giving your testimony what the Lord has done for you. And so when you're given the testimony of the Lord, you're speaking of what you've experienced personally. You can't give somebody else's testimony. You may be able to give mine because I've told it to you so many times. You may be able to recite it. But you can't tell somebody else's testimony because it didn't happen to you. But the thing that's happened to you, the Lord's done for you when he saved your soul, or anything that he's helped you through, miraculous healing, or being brought up out of cancer, or whatever it may be in your life, restored your family. Maybe your family was apart and he restored it. Your job, maybe that he restored, or anything that happens in your life. We need to give glory to God and realize that that is a testimony to the Lord, and we should be sharing that testimony with other people. Paul told Timothy, don't be ashamed of it. Don't be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord. One of Timothy's problems was the problem of being kind of timid. If you read through the scripture about Timothy, it seems he might have had a little problem of being kind of backward. He also, I believe, had a problem with feeling like he wasn't being taken as serious as he should have been because of his youth. Because Paul said this, he told him in 1 Timothy 4:12, he said, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word and conversation and charity and spirit and faith and purity." So I believe that Paul was trying to help Timothy with a problem he was having in his spiritual walk, that maybe he felt like he wasn't worthy, or maybe he wasn't old enough. Maybe people wasn't giving him the credit he deserved. But Paul said, hey, don't be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord. Don't let man despise you because of your youth. But he, you know, there he tells Timothy, don't be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord. In other words, listen, Timothy, don't be afraid to tell people what the Lord has done for you. Don't be afraid to tell people how the Lord used your mother and your grandmother, how the Lord has brought you up and nurtured you, and you've learned the things of the Lord. Don't be ashamed of that. Tell the world about it, Timothy. Tell them how he saved you and how he's helped you on your daily walk. Well, this morning, like I said, both Karen and Sister Linda mentioned about that miracle sitting in the pew. Every one of us has a miracle. The problem is, most people don't realize what God has done for them. Or if they do, they credit somebody else or something else. Too many people today are wanting to give credit to everybody and to everything instead of giving credit to the Lord where it belongs. Something happens to you. Say you're sick. Say you get better, and you'll give credit to that doctor, or you'll give credit to that medicine, or you'll give credit to something you read off the internet that helped you or something. Friends, I want you to know today, if you got better from being sick, it was because the Lord healed you. No matter what the means was that was behind it, it was the Lord that blessed you enough to be healed. The Lord directs people to make medicines. The Lord's the one that gives man enough knowledge to be able to help other people, to be able to tell them what to do to get healed. The Lord's directing that surgeon's hands. The Lord's in the middle of everything. And so before you start giving credit to everything in this world, remember the source of all that is the Lord, and give him the credit. Give him the glory. Give him the testimony. And when you stand, when somebody says, hey, has anybody got anything they want to say about the Lord? Has anybody got a testimony? All you got is get up and say, you know what? Let me tell you what happened to me. And that's your testimony, what the Lord has done for you. And we all have them. Everybody in this church, everybody in this pew is a living miracle that God has done something for. If it's nothing more than telling your salvation story, get up and tell it. I don't ever get tired of hearing somebody tell how they got saved. I already know Brother Roger's pretty good. He's told us several times about getting knocked in the head, and I won't ever forget that. Friends, we need to tell people about our testimony. You all remember that I was 6 years old, 1972, Elm Street Baptist Church, sitting on a pew all the way back there around where OC and them are right now. I was sitting back there, not caring about the service, not wanting to listen to it, but that preacher started preaching, and my heart got convicted, and I knew I had to be saved, and I ran to that altar, and I got saved that night, and I've been saved ever since. Now, you all know my testimony, but I like to hear your testimony, and the Lord wants to hear your testimony. It's to bring glory to Him, not us. Not us at all. It's to bring glory to God. Well, very rarely do you hear testimonies like you used to. Used to, you're going to church, and boy, there's always somebody ready to give a testimony. Whether it's some little old lady that the Lord had helped her through something, helped her out in her time of need. Maybe she didn't have groceries in the house, or she didn't have a way to get somewhere, and all of a sudden somebody showed up to take her, or whatever it was. I can always remember as a little boy, somebody standing up somewhere in the church and say, "I just want to say what the Lord's done for me this week." And you would hear, that was almost every service you heard something like that. Nowadays, nobody wants to share a testimony of what the Lord has done for them. Well, Brother Byron, I'm backwards. Hey, I'm the most backwards person you've ever met, okay? Don't use that for an excuse, because that don't fly with me. I want to bring glory to God. If you've told that testimony 10 times or 50 times or 100 times, keep on telling it. There may be somebody here that's never heard it or didn't listen to you the last time. Tell that testimony. We need to give our testimony. Don't be ashamed of it. Some people say, I've heard people say, my testimony about when I got saved, it's just not exciting. I've heard other people give their testimony, and boy, how the Lord has brought them out of drugs and alcohol and abusive home and all these things, and the Lord really helped them out. Boy, it was just a miracle. And my testimony's not like that. Mine ain't either. You know what? A six-year-old boy, what's the worst thing I'd done? I stole a wax harmonica out of the grocery store. That's the worst thing that I can think of. Boy, I got a whooping for that. I had to go back to the store and apologize, and we had to pay for it. And I'll never forget my lesson in stealing. That's the worst thing that I can remember that I'd done. And so my testimony is nothing like one of these you may hear of somebody getting pulled out of, the pits of hell like that. But I was still pulled out of the pits of hell, regardless if it was stealing a little wax harmonica or telling a little lie or whatever it was. I was just as hellbound as that man that's a drug addict or that man that's a drunkard or that man that's a wife abuser, a child abuser, a molester or anything like that. I was just as bad and just as hellbound as that person was. And my testimony is just as strong as that. And friends, yours is too. If the Lord saves you tonight, your testimony is the same miracle that that person's testimony is. And you need to be telling the world about it. Friends, I'll never forget when the Lord saved me. How many times have you told people we need to tell it? Are we ashamed of Him? If you read through the Bible, you'll find men and women of God all through the Bible giving testimony of what God did for them. I'm reminded of old King David. King David, out of all the people in the Bible, boy, the Psalms, if you read the Psalms, you go down through there, King David, testimony after testimony after testimony. The Lord did this. The Lord did that. The Lord lifted me up. The Lord pulled me out of the miry clay. The Lord put me on a solid rock. The Lord did this. The Lord did that. All through the Bible, King David stands up and said, "Let me tell you what the Lord did for me." He shared his testimony, friends. If you want to look at it, look at Psalms 40, 1 and 2. Psalm 40. 1 and 2. And I'll give you an example of old King David and what he used to do. Psalm 40, 1 and 2. Here in Psalm 40, 1 and 2, David writes this. He says, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit and out of the miry clay, and He set my feet upon a rock and established my goings." If your Bible's anything like mine, up there at the heading of that, it probably says, "To the chief musician, a psalm of David." Now, those words aren't from the inspired text, but they were added in there by the King James translators to let us know who wrote these Psalms right here. And it says right there, this is a Psalm of David. And it gives us an understanding of who wrote it. Well, we all know King David is the greatest king to ever be in Israel, except the Lord Jesus. But he was the greatest king of all. The Bible says he was a man after God's own heart. We all know his ups and his downs, and David had his trials and tribulations and things he did wrong. But we have an understanding the Lord loved David, and David loved the Lord. And David, at any chance, at any time he got, you know what he did? He said, let me tell you what the Lord did for me. He pulled me up out of the miry clay. He put my foot upon the rock. He said, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to hear me and heard my cry. David waited patiently upon the Lord. How many times, or how many people, I hear people all the time say, Brother Byron, I prayed about that and nothing ever happened. Once? You prayed for it one time? Is that all you did? You prayed for it one time? Well, you know, the preacher on TV said to pray about it and forget it. It's not what my Bible says to do. The Bible right here says that David waited patiently on the Lord. Do you think that he got up from the altar there and said, you know, I prayed about it, now I'm going to forget it? No, David kept on. David was, at one point in the scripture, he said he was laying in a bed of water. The tears were so much, he's laying on that couch that it was soaked and full of water. David waited patiently upon the Lord. Here in Psalm 6:6, he says, I'm weary with my groaning. All the night make I my bed to swim. I'll water my couch with my tears. Mine eyes consume because of grief. It waxeth old because of all mine enemies. I tell you what, friends, if something's important to you, important enough to pray, keep on praying about it. Pray without ceasing, the Bible says. And David, he says, I waited patiently on the Lord. And what you know what he did? He inclined to hear me. He inclined to hear my prayer. The Lord heard my prayer and he answered it. It says, and heard my cry. Verse 2 there, he said, he brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. Now, we hear his testimony. That's David's testimony. Time after time through Scripture, we read of David giving testimony to the Lord. Listen, and let me tell you what the Lord has done for me. Here in this second verse, he's talking about being in a horrible pit. The scene of a man, he's hopeless, he's helpless, and he's going down. He has no, there's no bottom there. He's sinking, and he's in a panic. Then a strong man comes by, and he sees the poor man, that wretched man, sinking down in that miry clay. And you know what? It don't say that the strong man came by and said, boy, I hope you make it out of that pit. It don't say that. The strong man didn't leave him down in there in that pit. He brought him up out of there. He doesn't look at him and say, good luck, hope you get out soon. No, he pulls him up out of there safely and puts him on a rock where he cannot sink. So the man sings a song of praise for his rescuer. You know, I had a similar experience to this when I was a little boy. I was about 12. And my best friend, Kevin Roberts, Frank's son, we went all over the place. I mean, playing in the fields and crossing fences and jumping in ponds and creeks and barns and you name it, we did it. And there was a place up there just below where Chester lives, down below the gully in between my mom and dad's property and Chester's. And there was a place in the ground, and it was a big old wet, muddy place. And it was bigger than this podium right here, and about 6 feet long, 6 feet wide or so. We've got the whole acreage to walk around this one place, okay? All I had to do was do this to get around it. But no, that wasn't good enough. Me and Kevin decided we got to jump over this big muddy hole. And so here we are, Kevin. Now, Kevin's about 4 inches taller than me, and he's about 100 pounds lighter than me. He was wiry and fast. Well, Kevin said, well, I'll go first. And he takes off running, and he leaps over that big muddy pit, you know, by a long shot, makes it 3 or 4 feet past it. I said, well, if Kevin can do it, I can do it. And so I took off running, my little old, what they call husky self. I took off running, and I leaped, and you know what? I jumped up in the middle of the air, and I came straight down in the middle of that mud pit. Straight down. We didn't test it before we jumped over it. Do you know what? When I hit that mud pit, I went down, and I was already up under my arms. It was already up to my shoulders, and I was sinking. I mean, I could barely get my hands out. By the time I was there, I was up to my neck in that mud, and I was just going down. There was nothing below my feet. It was just sinking and sinking and sinking. There's a big sinkhole under there. I didn't know that. Well, Kevin, he lays down on the ground beside of it, and he reaches out with his hand, and he starts pulling me out of that muddy pit, and he pulls me up out of that miry clay and up on the solid ground, and that's what the Lord did for me when he saved me. I was going down in a muddy mire, down in the pits of hell, and the Lord saved me, and he pulled me up out of there, and he put me on a solid rock, on the foundation of Jesus Christ, and I've been there ever since, and I've never come off of it. He's never took me off of it, and friends, one of these days, I'm going to be right there in the presence to the Lord, and I'm going to say, Lord, thank you for pulling me up out of that miry clay. Put me up on that solid rock to stay, God. Thank you, Lord. And that's my testimony, friends. That's my testimony. David said he pulled me up out of there and he put me on a firm foundation. And he said he established my going. He put my feet on the rock and he established my goings. I want you to realize David wasn't just talking about a big muddy hole behind his mom and dad's house. Friends, he was talking about much deeper than that. Look at the testimony David gives about what the Lord did for him. First of all, he said the Lord gave him healing. The Lord has gave David healing. I'm not talking about physical healing here. I'm talking about spiritual healing. All through the Bible, sin is looked upon as a disease. And it's a disease that is, it doesn't leave anybody out. Sin is on every man. It can strike anybody at any time, and it's like a cancer. It doesn't care how old you are, how young you are, how skinny you are, how fat you are, how good looking you are, how ugly you are, how rich you are, how poor you are. Sin doesn't care. Sin is in every man and woman. It just wants to come in and do damage. Every person sitting under the sound of my voice tonight is afflicted with the disease called sin. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 7:20, for there is not a just man upon earth that doeth good and sinneth not. That encompasses everybody. Sin is for everybody. And since we're all afflicted with this disease of sin, we all need to be healed. How do we need to be healed? We need to be spiritually healed. When Jesus hung on the cross of Calvary, like Roger was just singing about over there a while ago, when he hung on that cross and shed every drop of his precious blood, he had healing in that blood that day. Jesus has healing in that blood, the healing in the stripes. With his stripes, we are healed, the Bible says, over in Isaiah 53. And I want you to know that tonight. When we trust him as Savior, he heals our spiritual sickness, our disease of sin. You know, I'm going to tell you this story. I might have told this before. There was a well-known Chicago businessman. He was addicted to alcohol. And this is back when they used to ride on trains. And he would go out with his business buddies, and they would get on the train, they'd ride from place to place, and they all knew that he drunk. He was drunk all the time. And one of the men, he had a little flask in his jacket, and he pulled it out, and pulled off the top, and he handed it over to that man. He said, here, you want a drink? And that man says, no, I'm never drinking again. They thought he was kidding. And they said, what are you talking about? You're never going to drink again. He said, I'm never going to drink again. They said, how come? He said, let me tell you what happened. He said, last week I went home and I went down to a pawn shop and I went in there and I was waiting around and this young man came in the door and he was holding this little package in his hands. And he came up there to the pawnbroker and he said, I need some money for this. Would you trade me some money for this? And that pawnbroker, he said, look, buddy, he said, your kid needs those shoes more than you need that liquor. And he said, oh, no, my baby don't need them shoes anymore. My baby died last night. And that man said, I heard that guy say that. And he realized how low down that brought him out. Sin had brought that man down and destroyed his family, destroyed everything about him. He said, I went home and I got on my knees and I prayed and I asked the Lord to save me that night. And he said, I will never drink another drop of alcohol in my life. Friends, that's what the Lord can do for a person. That was that man's testimony. Friends, I don't know what your testimony is. You do, and the Lord does, but I want you to know tonight, everybody else needs to hear your testimony. You don't know what a difference it may make in somebody else's lives. I told you about at my father's funeral when I read that thing, he talked about heaven. And all these churches, then people went and shared it at other churches. And a man, 82-year-old man, went and got saved because he heard that. I want you to know tonight, you don't know what your testimony is going to do in this world. And we all need to share those testimonies. David, the Lord, he says the Lord gave him help. When a baby is born, you don't just leave them alone. They need help. They need nourishment. When a person gets saved, help and nourishment are provided. It's a wonderful, glorious thing to get saved, but the battle's not over. It's only began. People say, you know, you need to get saved, your life's going to change and everything's going to be fine from here on out. Oh, no, friend. Once they get saved, they need to have somebody to discipleship. They need some discipleship right there. They need somebody to come, a man or a woman of God, to help those that are new in the faith. They need them to come along with them and say, here's what you need to do in your Christian walk. You need to attend church faithfully. You need to read the Bible faithfully. You need to pray to the Lord faithfully. And you need to share with others about Jesus. That's what you need to do. But all so many times, we want to get them down here to the altar, see them saved, and they walk out that door, and that's the last time we hear from them. It ought not to ever be that way. That's one of the scourges of the Baptist church today, of letting people out the door and never following up with them and seeing if they need help. Friends, it ought not to be that way. The Bible says, that David said, the Lord helped him there. He gave him help. It's wonderful to think about that. There's people on this earth that's told me that they love me, you know. They say, well, I love you, Brother Byron. You ever pastor a church, I'll be one of your most faithful members. They hadn't been through the door yet. There's more than one person's told me that. They ain't been here yet. Friends, I tell you what, the Lord will help you, but people, you can't count on people. Anytime I've ever called on Jesus, He's been there to help me. And I can provide a testimony for that tonight. There's never been a time that I've heard a busy signal from the Lord. All I've got down and I've prayed and I said, Lord, I need help. Lord, I'm in a fix. And you know what? I always know that He's listening and He's there for me. Thirdly, David, the Lord gave him hope. It gave him hope. There's nothing sadder than a man or a woman without any hope in this life. You know people like that. They walk around, they just seem hopeless. I mean, they're just giving up. They're giving up on life. They don't care if they get out of bed the next day. I mean, this world, they're just like old Eeyore. Oh, that's all I can do. The Lord's just got it out for me. I can't do anything. Some people place all their hope in their money, in their work, in saving, buying homes, buying automobiles. You know, I know people that they spend their life trying to get that next big purchase. They think the next big thing that they buy is going to make them happy. But they never find happiness. The only place you're ever going to find that kind of happiness to fill that void that's in your heart is when you allow Jesus into that heart. And then Jesus will fill up that hole that you've got. And Jesus will put His love within you, and He'll fill you up, and then you'll understand what it's like. Money can't buy you hope, but the Lord gives you hope. What a friend we have in Jesus. I tell you what, you've not had any hope till you place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. That's when you'll have hope. I got another story I wrote down to give you. Two men, they lay dying. One man asked the other man, sir, what is your hope? The man replied, well, I've always lived a good life. I've tried to do my best in this world. I've never hurt anybody. I didn't ever go to church, and I never was a Christian. But I've always been good, and so my hope is that I'll go to heaven. You'd be surprised how many people believe that today. You can go around and knock on some doors around here, and people will tell you that they've lived a good life, and they think they're going to go to heaven. I've actually talked to people, they say, I hope I'm going to heaven. And I'll say, well, you know that you can know you're going to heaven. And they say, yeah, I know. You know, they don't want to talk about it. But they don't know. They don't know that they're going to heaven. Friends, you can know you're going to heaven. You don't have to wonder about it. It's a biblical fact. You know how if you're going to get to heaven or not, if you've placed trust in Jesus as your Savior. But many people will rely upon their good works. And the man says, I hope I get to heaven. The other man was laying there dying. He was asked the same question. And he replied this way. He said, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. That's what the other man replied. Friends, I hope that's your testimony tonight, that you can say, I'm relying upon the solid rock, upon the name of Jesus. Fourth thing, and I'm finished. Fourth and final thing, the Lord gives him heaven. Christ gives a man four things: healing, help, hope, and heaven. Yet some men are so foolish to say, I don't want Christ. I don't want Him. I don't want all these things that He gives. People don't want it. They say they don't, but friends, they don't know any better. In the end, they're going to plead for it. They're going to beg for it. They're going to wish with all their heart that they had made that decision. But I'm afraid it'll be too late. It will be too late if they leave this walk of life unsaved. It will be too late for them. Oh, but how they'll remember those times when the Lord convicted their heart. But friends, if you've got a testimony tonight, you need to be sharing that with other people. And I know that being a pastor, I've been involved in a lot of funerals, a lot of families, both Christians and non-Christians. And you can tell those that don't have the Lord Jesus in their lives. It's a very different funeral service. Those that don't have hope in Christ, they're miserable. They don't have any hope at all. Oh, we're all sad from our loss as a Christian. But we do have hope. We have hope in the Lord Jesus. We have hope that we will see our loved ones again. We're not concerned about that part of it. But those that are not saved, friends, they have no hope. All they think is their body's going to go and rot in the ground, and they mourn and weep over that. But friends, we can have hope in Jesus tonight. He gives us hope, hope of heaven. I know I'm considered a young man, only 49, but I've been around long enough to realize this earth, this world, doesn't have any hope for me. My hope is up in heaven, up in my heavenly home. I'm a citizen of heaven. Ever since 1972, that's where my citizenship lies. Oh, I may have a passport. I may have a driver's license or something that says I'm a citizen of the United States, but they don't know any better. If they knew I was a citizen somewhere else, they'd think I was an illegal alien. You know, Donald Trump may be talking about me for long. I don't know, but I am a citizen of heaven tonight. I'm not a citizen of here. I've got family members waiting on me. I've got heaven's sweeter today than it's ever been. I can't wait to see my daddy again. I can't wait to see my sister Pam again. I just know her and Barbara's up there right now playing piano together. Dad's probably playing a guitar. I don't know what they're doing, but I do know they're there. I've heard their testimony. They told me how they got saved, and I know that's where their hope was, and that's where they were going. Friends, it's sweeter for me. All my granny, my papa, all my grandparents, all those that went on before me, but most of all, the one that died for me, the one that gave me this hope, the one that pulled me up out of the pits of hell, the one that put my feet on a solid rock, the one that gave me eternal life. That's the one that I want to see the most, the Lord Jesus. What about you tonight? What do you want written down about you when you leave? What's your testimony going to be? Do you want your record to say he rejected Christ and was lost forever? Or do you want the record to say, you know what, we heard their testimony. We heard that they were saved. We heard them give glory to the Lord for all the things he had done. That's what I want to hear. I hope people hear that about me. He gave his testimony. I hope at my funeral service they can say, let me tell you how Brother Byron got saved. You don't have to worry about him. Because he told us over and over and over. We got tired of hearing it. He told us many times. But they'd be able to tell it. What about you tonight? Will people know your testimony? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for the message. Lord, I pray that it's helped somebody tonight. Lord, it's reached hearts, God, and we realize the importance of our testimony. We realize, God, that we are not to be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord. God, that you love us, Lord. And you're to be glorified in our lives and everything that we do. Lord, I'm praying for our congregation here tonight, for our church, and our testimonies. God, may the world hear them. Lord, may we not keep them secret. Help us here tonight, Father. If there's one in need, whatever it may be, Lord, would you help them? And we'll give you the praise for it all. For these things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.